All right, good morning. Normally we just jump right in and start singing, but I have a request.
Okay,
so does she.
So does she.
That's what I said. We're going to need some help on Sunday mornings with the words. Sandy's, I think, helping us this morning, but sometimes she's, when we're doing the internet stuff, she's got to be over there doing that. And so we're going to need somebody to run the words. And it's real easy. You just click on the words. And
I'll show you how. It's not a, and all you got to do it just during the singing, and then I'll take over during the sermon. So it's just usually just a couple of clicks, and we can get you through it. So no big deal.
God is all right, good. God is good. Amen.
Well, you're back here. You can't do it.
God is good all the time. He put a song of praise in this heart of mine. God is good all the time. Through the darkest night, His light will shine. God is good. God is good all the time. If you're walking
babysitting.
From heaven above with wisdom.
Okay, asterisk. I don't know why we didn't asterisk on the last one. I'm just shocked. Be bold, be strong, for the Lord God is with you. Be bold, be strong, for the Lord God is with you. I am not afraid, I am not dismayed, because I'm walking in faith and victory. Come on and walk in faith and victory, for the Lord your God is with you. Be strong,
for the Lord
God is with you. Be bold, be strong, for the Lord God is with you. I am not afraid, I am not dismayed, because I'm walking in faith and victory. Come on and walk in faith and victory, for the Lord your God is with you. Be bold. Strong, for the Lord God is with you. Be bold, be strong, for the Lord God is with you. I am not afraid, I am not dismayed, because I'm walking in faith and victory. Come on and walk in faith and victory, for the Lord your God is with you. All right, now we're going to sing about a little victory in Jesus. Amen.
I heard an old, old story, how a Savior came from glory, how he gave his life on Calvary just to save a wretch like me. I heard about his groanings, of his precious blood.
there's a lighthouse.
There's a lighthouse on the hillside that overlooks life's sea. When I'm tossed, it sends out a light so that I might see. And the light that shined in darkness now will safely lead me home.
Speed it up a little bit.
Yeah.
Ooh. 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 Ooh.
Bring your tide and bring your shame. Bring your guilt and bring your pain. Don't you know? You always
is the one living inside of me than he who was living in the world.
There'll be days
of battle. Grace says that it doesn't matter, cause the cross already won the war.
Be greater.
I am learning to run freely, understand just how he sees me, and it makes me love him more and more.
He's greater.
There'll be days I lose the battle. Grace says that it doesn't matter, cause the cross already won the war.
Be greater.
I am learning to run freely, understand just how he sees me, and it makes me love him more and more.
He's greater.
Oh, cause I hear a voice and he calls me redeemed. When others say I'll never be enough, and greater is the one living inside of me than he who is living in the world. In the world. In the world. Days I lose the battle. Grace says that it doesn't matter, cause the cross already won the war.
He's greater.
I am learning to run freely, understand just how he sees me, and makes me love him more and more.
He's greater.
Oh, my God is greater than he who is living in the world.
Just get right back up, because we're going to sing Get Up.
Get up. Get up.
Okay. I'm ready when you
it's
are.
Yours.
Get up. Get up in Jesus' name. The Lord is calling daily those that would be saved.
Don't
go down defeated while victory's here to claim. Get up in Jesus' name. At the gate called Beautiful, they're laid out in the street. A poor and lonely beggar who's crippled in his feet. As John and Peter passed him, they saw his knee was bad. They had no gold and silver, but they gave him all he had. Get up in Jesus' name. The Lord is calling daily those that would be saved. Don't go down defeated while victory's here to claim. Get up in Jesus' name. In the day which we live in, there's evil everywhere, and overcome with courage, and overcome with fear. Well, God is needing soldiers to get out of the pew and take all the power that John and Peter used. Get up in Jesus' name. The Lord is calling daily those that would be saved. Don't go down defeated while victory's here to claim. Get up in Jesus' name. Get up in Jesus' name. The Lord is calling daily those that would be saved. Don't go down defeated while victory's here to claim. Get up in Jesus' name.
Okay, I took away the asterisk.
Huh? My turn?
Yes.
Okay. How about a hand for
our house band here, huh? Are you enjoying the music? Me too. God is good. And all the time. Have you looked over at the porch? Did you see the roof? That's pretty nice, ain't it? I want to thank everybody that come out and helped. And as we go along, we've got some other things. Hopefully at the end of this week, we'll have the steps completed. Then we're going to stain it and seal it. And then we're going to put some electric in it. And we're going to put the ceiling on the roof. And, well, we're just getting ready to really have a good time out there on that porch. Amen. Now, I don't know if you know, not next week, but the week after is Vacation Bible School. Okay? So if you plan on helping, please get with Dallas and Jeannie, and we'll go from there. Okay? I'm just glad to see y'all. Y'all had a good week? You know, we need to claim that victory. Don't be defeated, like the song says. Now, devil's going to continue to throw missiles at you. But don't accept them. We got to continue to stay victorious, right? So when we come in here and we're all downhearted, this is the place to come and get fired up again. Because our Lord is still on the throne. Amen? Well, we've been doing a series called Building a Fire. We talked about who we are in Christ and why we through God we have all this power. We've talked about that. And we've talked about how we need to make a difference in the world around us, didn't we? We talked about going out and making a difference. Well, today I want to talk about a deal that we all have, and it's called comfort zones. Oh, boy. He's going there. But we live in comfort zones, don't we? And some of us love to live there. Some of us visit them from time to time, and some of us have learned to ignore the comfort zones. But there's comfort zones in everybody's life, amen? I guess my question will be for you, and the title of this sermon is, will you step out of your comfort zone? So as I said, we're talking about building this fire. And I've never been more on fire than when I seen God work around me. Amen? When you see His touch in someone's life. I told you before, my mother-in-law was not a saved Christian. And so I was praying to God. I wanted her to be saved, of course, because she's my mother-in-law. And plus, I thought it'd make her a little bit more pleasant to be around. Yeah, John is not here. My wife's with her friends. So, but anyway, so I felt like God told me to fast on Tuesdays and Thursdays. Okay. And what I mean by fasting, and I'm not making nothing, I'm just telling you I felt like He told me to fast, and I could drink water and coffee, and that was it. Couldn't eat food. I could drink during that time. In about a month and a half of doing that, my mother-in-law got saved. And I was never more happy, right? I felt victory. I seen my Lord work. Now, fasting was definitely out of my comfort zone. All right? I didn't like that. I'm not real partial to fasting unless, anyway. But if the God tells me, we're going to have to do it. But I'm just telling you, when we step out of our comfort zone and we do what God leads us to do, we can see amazing things, can't we? What do you think about old Noah? Think old Noah stepped out of his comfort zone a little bit? Yeah, what do you think? They didn't even have rain then. And the Lord says, hey, I'm going to rain. What do you got? What are you talking about, God? I'm going to break water from the sky. What? And I want you to build a boat this big. What? He stepped out of his comfort zone. What did it do? It saved him and his family, didn't it? Today, as we continue on building this fire and considering the teaching of Jesus on the Holy Spirit, I want to read in John, the 14th chapter. And I'm going to read a little bit more than what we're really going to get to, but John 14, starting with verse 6 through 17. John 14, 6 through 17. Jesus said to him, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father except through me. If you have known me, you would have known my Father also. And from now on, you know him and have seen him. Philip said to him, Lord, show us the Father, and it will, it is, what is the word I'm looking for, Kai? Sufficient for us. Jesus said to him, have I been with you so long, and yet you have not known me, Philip? He who has seen me has seen the Father. So how can you say, show us the Father? Do you not believe that I am in the Father and the Father in me? The words that I speak to you, I do not speak on my own authority, but the Father who dwells in me, he does the works. Believe me that I am the Father, that I in the Father and the Father in me, or else believe me for the sake of the works themselves. Most assuredly, I say to you, he who believes in me, the works that I do, he will do also, and greater works than these he will do, because I go to my Father. And whatever you ask in my name, that I will do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you ask anything in my name, I will do it. If you love me, keep my commandments, and I will pray the Father, and he will give you another helper, that he may abide with you forever, the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it neither sees him nor knows him. But you know him, for he dwells with you and in you. Lord, Father, I just ask you to be with us today. Lord, take over this service, Father. May your Holy Spirit come in here and swirl around, Father, and touch each and every one of us underneath this roof, Father. Will you bring the message that you would have brought? Lord, I ask you to touch the brokenhearted today, Father, and lift them up, Lord. And Lord, let us truly understand who we are, that we have victory, and take us out of our comfort zones to see and glorify you. This we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. What is your comfort zone? What is your comfort zone? These invisible barriers that make us feel safe and secure, isn't it? All of us have comfort zones, don't we? All of us have a place, a comfort zone. Some of us surround ourselves with them. Some of us live in them. Some of us visit them. Some of us have learned to ignore them. When we get used to something, or when we have done something in a particular way for a long time or for a while, or when we just don't want anything to change, those are the times we find ourselves in a comfort zone. Amen? I tell you, in the Army, the longer you're in, you start falling into these comfort zones. Because really the problems in the military doesn't change. It's the same thing. It just comes up with a different, they name it something else and it comes back. And we have this rotation. And after you've been there, and this is when you know you're about ready to retire, and the same way your jobs, whatever you do, these problems re-arise over and over and over. And at the end of your career, you say, oh, we've already did that and it won't work. Right? I've seen this before, and we tried that, and it ain't going to work. Do you agree? We stay in our comfort zone. We make excuses for us to stay in it. Oh, we tried that a long time ago, and it just didn't work. Do you understand what I'm saying? When we come to church, and if we do something a little different here at church, oh, I don't like that, preacher. I don't like what you're doing. We ain't never done that before. Have you ever told God that? Be careful. Be careful. Has God called you to do something before, and it just wasn't in your comfort zone, so you say, ah, well, that ain't going to work. You know, some people say the only people that really like changes are babies with dirty diapers. I'm telling you, if you stay in your comfort zone, you need to have your diapers changed because you're starting to stinketh. You know, we need to be honest with ourselves. Many times it's easier for us to keep doing the same thing over and over and over again, excuse me, than it is for us to allow change in our lives. Right? Now here's what I don't understand, and you may be guilty of it, and I know many people are. When they keep doing something over and over, the same thing, then they go, I need help. This is what happens. You've done this for 3 years. You've not changed nothing. And you're continually wanting help. You continually, hey, where I'm from, that's called insanity. Right? So why is our churches doing the same thing over and over and over and over again, and they're not growing? And they stay in their comfort zone and say, well, I'm not, no, we're not. Now, we ain't going to take that horse and buggy and go out here and evangelize Afton. That just don't make sense to me. Hey, it's different. It'll be out of some of y'all's comfort zone. Hey, just knocking on doors and saying, hey, would you come visit Bar None Cowboy Church is going to be out of a lot of us, our comfort zones. Right? So we'll make up excuses. Oh, I don't like riding in them wagons. When I was a kid one time, my grandpa and that wagon, them horses got away from us, and I ain't getting in that wagon no more. Right? Or I don't talk very well. Listen, your preacher can't pronunciate anything. Right? And I use words wrong. But you get the point. Right? Yeah, I need a lot of it. What I'm saying is, we got to step outside our comfort zone because God will use us. Amen? Noah, he didn't know anything about building boats, but he got her done, didn't he? Why? Because he listened to the Spirit of God, and he did exactly what he was told to do. Amen? If you're honest with ourselves, we got to realize that we don't like change as human beings very well. Even when it's God's will that change should happen in our lives, or when it is God's will that change should happen in the life of the church, we choose the comfortable option, the safe option. Don't do nothing. Don't we? Have you ever done that? I have. Have you ever chosen the safe option? You bet. When it gets a little bit stressful, what do? We'll go back to what worked last time. Don't we? And sometimes it don't work. The option that says, I know God is bigger than this is the one we ought to be taking. I know God has said that all these things are possible for those who believe is what we need to grab a hold of. I know God is still in the God of miracles. That's what we need to be holding on to. But a lot of times when we do those things that come up, we say, well, just in case the situation is bigger than God, we start making excuses. We start putting ourselves back into this comfort zone. Listen, I prayed for people up here to be healed right now. And not always does it happen, okay? But I have faith that God's still in the healing business. I've got to step out of my comfort zone. You know, it's hard to answer a person. So I prayed for God. God said, I can be healed. I said, I'm going to pray for you too. And then they don't get healed. And they said, well, why is that? I said, man, I don't know. That's God's business. But I'm going to pray for you, and I'm believing that you're healed. I believe that my mother-in-law could get saved. It was his timing, as my brother said. But we got to stand on the things, the promises we got. We got to quit making up excuses for God. God does not need our human excuses. He'll take care of himself. Amen? A lot of times we say, I'm going to stay in my comfort zone and take the option that seems to be the safest. And we wonder why our churches are not growing. You know, we talked about it already. We need power. We need power from on high. You know, if a kid sees us, we don't do anything. We do the same thing over and over and over. Man, they don't want no part of this. They want to see power. We need to come in here with smiles on our face, man. You get to worship God without getting put up in front of a firing squad. Can you smile about that? I know there's people that has to sneak around to worship God just because they'll get killed. Remember John and Peter? What happened to them? They got arrested, didn't they? What'd they do? They refused to stay in the comfort zone. They could have said, when they said they arrest them, they couldn't, didn't know what to do with them. And then, so they said, I tell you what, John, Peter, here's the deal. We know you healed that cripple out there, and we saw you do that, you know. But we're going to tell you, quit speaking this Jesus' name. Don't do that no more. And they could have said, well, okay. And here's what a lot of us might do, and I'm probably tend to, okay, go out and keep doing it, right? Or, okay, I'm going to save my life. But Peter and John didn't do that, did they? What did they say? Who am I to listen to, you or God? I'm asking you, when God speaks to you, do you stay in your comfort zone? Or do you listen to God and move out? See, I can't answer that question for you. You've got to answer that question. How many times has God told you to do something, you stayed in your comfort zone? And then you wonder why you're not seeing the rejoicing joys of God's work around your life. He needs you to do it. He wants to be there with you. Has anybody shared the gospel of Jesus Christ with somebody? I know you felt terrible after doing it, didn't you? Horrible. Yeah. You're a liar. You know, we got to step outside our comfort zone. We have been called to trust God. Have you been? Do you trust God? Be careful. Be careful. Do you trust God? Because a lot of times we don't. Oh boy, what am I going to do? God says, I'll meet your needs. Do you trust God? We have been called to follow Him. Sometimes it's hard to follow Him, isn't it? Especially in the world we live in. What are they doing to us? They're ridiculing us now. They're telling us we're uneducated. That's stupid. That's old stuff. That's died and gone away. He said, you follow me. You got to trust me. You got to follow me. And we have been told that He has promises in whatever and for whatever we need to do in our lives. Does He not? He gives us that hope. And it all goes back. He says, I will meet your needs. You're supposed to live in joy. You're supposed to go out here and witness for me. I am in you. You are in me. I am in the Father. The Father is in me. The Holy Spirit's going to come. I'm going to give you power from on high. And then it all goes back to, do you want that kind of life? Yes. Well, then here my bottom question is, do you trust Him? And will you step out of your comfort zone? Folks, it's very simple. When we're doing the things of God, we've got to trust Him. We've got to believe that He does what He says He'll do, no matter what it is. And that's how we step out of our comfort zone, truly believing God is who He says He is. We find ourselves fenced in by our own boundaries. We hide ourselves and we trap ourselves. We've tried to convince ourselves that it feels safe in these comfort zones. Now, I'm not knocking anybody. You worship God how you want to worship God, okay? As long as you're comfortable with it. Huh. It says David danced for God. Now, I'm not saying you have to start dancing in church. But I'm saying that's a comfort zone for some people. Even standing up and clapping. It's a comfort zone. I ain't going to do that. I may be out of tune. I don't know if you noticed, but a lot of people clapping in here, we clap off tune. It's okay. God loves you. It's all right. We can mess up. All right? Another thing is, some of us can't sing, but I'm still singing whether you like it or not. Why? Because I don't care. God said make joyful noise. God says I'm worthy of praise. We talked about being praising Him, and He's worthy. Come out of those comfort zones, guys. You don't have to be the tough cowboy when you're up against God because it don't work. He wants you out of your comfort zone. He wants to use you. We hide ourselves. We trap ourselves in our comfort zone. We build these walls around us, and then after a while, we'll build a fence around that because, boy, I make that preacher, he kind of gets me fired up, but I ain't going to let, No, I can't wait to get out of here, man. He may have me clapping. He may have me come up here and want some more of the Holy Spirit, a new infilling of the Holy Spirit, or a fresh filling. I ain't going to do that. Well, I'm going to tell you, it's not your pastor, it's your Lord. Okay? I ain't going to take credit for none of that. So then we wonder, am I coming out of my comfort zone? Or am I building this deal? I'm going to go to church, I'm going to be a good boy, I'm going to pay my tithes, and I'm going to leave. And that's not what God's got planned. We got to step out. We got to step out. Hey, you know this guy, what was his name, Peter? Remember Peter? Peter's got one thing on his apostle resume that nobody else does. He walked on water. He stepped outside the safety of that boat during a raging storm to see his Lord, to do what his Lord said. His Lord said, come. And he stepped out there. Amen? And you know what? And we step out a lot of time, and we step out on that water. We're trying to get out of our comfort zone. God tells us to do this, and not always does it go. We're just human. Sometimes it don't go like we thought it was going to go. But you know what? What happened? Peter took his eyes off Christ. He got associated with the world around him. He saw the storms instead of keeping focused on God. And we all do that from time to time, don't we? And it's pretty much a humanistic thing. We start looking at the situation around us. But here's the deal. You can always have faith in this. What did Jesus do when Peter started failing on his walk on the water? What did he do? What? He reached out and met his needs. His needs at that time was to have some oxygen. Right? His need was to stay above that water instead of sinking to the bottom. And he brought him in. Folks, do you believe that story? Can you stand your life on that story? We can. Because God said so, right? So do you trust him? Well, I don't know if Peter trusted Jesus at that point. He did at first because he stepped out. I don't know when he started sinking if he really trusted Jesus or he'd just say, oh, Lord, save me. But that's all right. We can scream out to God. He says, come boldly to me. I want you to come to me. It's okay. Some people, I've heard this. Have you ever heard this? Well, it seems like every time I go to God, it's because I need something. And I'm just not going to do it. Well, that's insane. That's like saying, boy, I'm thirsty, but every time I get thirsty, I drink water. God says, come to me, doesn't he? So quit trying to run it on your own. Step out of your comfort zone. Keep coming to him. He's promised us great things. And in our comfort zones, we choose to ignore God sometimes. We can't hide ourselves, so we try to hide ourselves away from what God wants us to do because we're afraid God's going to make me do something. God ain't going to make you do anything. He's going to ask you to do something. And when you do it, you're going to get the pleasure of serving the one and only living God. And then on top of that, you know what happens? Once you do that, then you feel this joy he promises. He promises us joy, doesn't he? You're going to have that joy. I know every one of you hate doing good things for people, but God says you'll have joy when you do what he asks you to do. Has your comfort zone become prison? I see this in the church today, in the 21st century church. We've made all these rules to protect a congregation, haven't we? We've made all these rules to protect somebody. And you know what? God can protect his own. Now, when people come, they say, I want to teach a Sunday school class, or I want to do this, or whatever. And I pray about it, of course, and I want to hear what God's got to say about it. But you know what? He'll tell me, because this is his church, he'll tell me when he thinks, I better back off there. You need to take a little break there, right? Otherwise, if I don't get that, I'm behind it. You know why? Because God's big enough to take care of his church, what do you think? Amen. And he's big enough to take care of you, what do you think? And so I have to put my actions in I got to put my beliefs in action. That's why when people come to preach here, I'm not jealous at all. I'm glad that they come. Justin McKee, I'm glad he come. Did I tell y'all what he said? I called him. I said, Justin, thanks for coming. I got a lot of reports from y'all. I really enjoyed Justin. He did a good job. I said, they really loved you. He said, oh, Dean. He said, what a congregation. He said, I just loved them so much. The spirit was just so full there. He said, I got more out of it than I could have ever give them. I needed that. I'm not jealous. Guess who's coming back next Sunday? Kevin. Kevin Fielder. Friend of mine from junior college. Don't ask him to tell no stories. No.
Yeah, we'll get some of that. Don't worry about that.
I'm going to call him this week and tell him. Because I run around with him too. Kevin does a good job. He's a very intelligent man. He teaches at John Brown over in Siloam Springs. He'll bring a message from God. I'm happy that he's coming. But I trust in God. This is not my church. This is God's church. This is Jesus' church, not mine. It's not yours either. This is a congregation where you come. This is where we meet together as a group of individuals. But we got to come out of our comfort zones. We got to start trusting God. Amen? During the war, World War II, there was a spy that was captured by the Japanese. And before carrying out the sentence, the Japanese general of the concentration camp would ask this. He asked this spy. He told him, you can choose between two things here. You can choose between a firing squad or that black door over there. I thought for a minute, he said, I'll just take the firing squad. All right. And so they line him up, and he was properly disposed of very quickly. The general turned to his assistant and said, they always prefer the known way to the unknown. So he says, well, what's behind the black door? He said, freedom. Behind the big black door is a passageway that leads outside, but only a few have been brave enough to see what was behind the door. Folks, if you want God to work magnificent things in your life, you've got to be willing to go to the unknown with him. Noah did. Moses did. Didn't he? Gideon did. Peter did. Isn't that awesome? But our human nature wants us to know everything's okay before we make any step forward. We've got to come out of our comfort zones. We've got to let the Holy Spirit work in us. Give us power from on high. What's the big black door in your life that God's give you the option to go through? What is it? What's God been working in your life asking you to step out more in faith? Listen, if you truly believe in Jesus Christ, if you've truly been saved, I'm telling you, God's got a black door he's wanting you to go through because he promised, I've started the work in you, that I will continue until you're finished. He's also promised us joy and fruitfulness, right? He wants us to bring more people into the kingdom of God. So I'm telling you, whether you like it or not, there's a black door somewhere for you to walk through that God's ready to take you through so you can see freedom, so you can see victory, so you can see all the joy of life. You can see God at work. But I tell you what, we've built these walls up. We've built these fences up. We ain't going to go there. And some of you has got so comfortable behind these walls and these fences that you don't even see the black door anymore, and nor do you want to. And I'm going to tell you, God's got something great for you. He'll take care of you. He took care of the sparrows, does he not? Sparrows don't plant food. Now, here's the deal. The sparrows don't give handed to them in their nest either, do they? They have to go out and work a little bit. We've got to step out in faith. Amen? I'm telling you, if you get out of your comfort zone, there's a few things going to happen. First of all, you're going to experience God like you've never experienced him before. If you stay in that comfort zone, you're going to continue to experience the God that you trap in there with you. But I'm going to tell you, a lot of us try to put God in a box, and we need to go over and open the lid on the box, and I'm going to tell you what happened. He's gone. He's not there anymore. He's bigger than any box. He's bigger than anything I can try to make him out to be. He's bigger than that. I can make up anything in my mind that I think God is, and he's bigger than that. He's better than that. He's bolder than that. He's got great plans. He's got things unbelievable to us that can happen. But we continue to stay in this comfort zone, and we don't see anything change in our lives, and we wonder why. And I'm going to tell you, it's because you've got to step out of your comfort zone. You've got to step out in faith. Man, it's not easy, man. I'm telling you, I know. I'll be honest with you. It wasn't easy when we left Flying Cow Arena. Not at all. It wasn't easy. I felt like that's what we had to do. God's blessed us. It's not on my timeline. It's on his. And he'll continue to bless us as long as we continue to stay out of our comfort zone and step forward for him. Amen? Now, I'm going to tell you something. I like using Kai because I love Kai. He's a unique man. He's done a lot of things. But you think about this. He used to be a bullfighter. Now, don't hold it against him. He really is intelligent. Okay? But he used to fight bulls. Okay? And you know they have competitions for that. Do you know that? Okay. They have competitions for bullfighting. Matter of fact, we got a real good one right over here at Veneta named Evan Allen, right? Yeah. Allard, yeah. Really good. If you know Evan, you can understand why he fights bulls. He's crazy. He's a fun guy, I'm telling you. There's no dull moment with that guy. But when you're fighting bulls, in order to get better, you got to take some chances, don't you, Kai? I think I've seen a video of Evan on his hands and knees in front of a bull about from me to Scott going, scraping the ground. Now, for me, that's out of the park. I'm not going there right now. I'm not ready for that. But can you imagine the first time he got on his hands and knees and staring into one of these fighting bulls' face? Or the first time you jumped over him head first? You know, in my mind, all I'm thinking is, he's going to catch my foot. He's going to flip me. Then he's going to turn around and stomp on me. He's going to roll me up. You know, all these things are going through my head. In order to be good at what you do, you got to come out of your comfort zone, right? And I promise you, Kai's come out of his comfort zone. When he fought bulls, he had to. Evan has. Now, let me ask you this. How many wants to be a world-class disciple of Jesus? Doesn't it make sense that you might have to come out of your comfort zone to get better? I'm not no rocket scientist. But I'm thinking maybe we need to come out of our comfort zone if we really want to serve God. Amen? And you know, really, we think about it, is it really a chance with God? No. He's got it covered. Even if we fail at something, maybe we missed something, maybe we didn't quite get it, you know, we're all right because it's on God. I've told you all along, we've studied how to share Jesus without fear. And the one thing I got out of that message is this. Whose job is it to save people? God's, right? The Holy Spirit. But yet, we'll make up excuses not to witness. But here's the deal. Whose gets embarrassed, me or the Holy Spirit? It ain't my job. All I'm supposed to do is tell them about it. The job of saving somebody and bringing somebody to God is the Holy Spirit. So he can be embarrassed if he wants to. I'm not going to. Does that make sense? So why do we build up these walls of comfort? Only thing I can think of, and forgive me, but if a shoe fits, wear it. We're lazy. And we're scared. And God said, in the kingdom of God, there is no fear. So where does it fit? Are you either you're lazy or you're scared? I guess there's one other thing. You're just goofy. You're just not serving God. Could it be any of those? I don't mean to browbeat anybody, because I fit all three of the above. Okay? But God wants us to step out of our comfort zone and step into the destiny that God has planned for us. He says he's got a great plan for you, doesn't he? So he wants us to step out. We need to leave behind this prison of fear, this prison of embarrassment, this prison that Satan's told you that well, you're not good enough to do that, this prison of condemnation, this prison of the past life that God don't even remember anymore. We got to break loose of those prisons, and we got to step forward out of our comfort zone. Yes? I ask you, where are you this morning? Where are you this morning? Are you missing out on the blessings and abundant life that Jesus promised? Because you refuse to leave the comfort zone. Folks, God has a great plan for this congregation, both as a group and as individuals. But we will not reach that goal, that plan, until we step out and truly trust and believe in God. And just do it. Just do it. Just believe in him. All it takes is a step of faith. A step of faith that will lead to a great blessing. A step of faith that will change your lives and other lives. A step of faith that brings glory to God our Father. A step of faith that leaves the comfort zone behind. And when we start stepping out of these comfort zones, we become a new creature in him. Because the more I use my faith, the more I step out in what God wants me to do, the more I see God work, and the more I see God work, guess what happens? My faith gets higher and higher and higher and more and more, and then there's just nothing I can't do through the Christ and Jesus Christ. Amen? So why do we continue to sit here and try to say, well, I wish I knew what God wanted me to do. I'm telling you, he's leading you how he wants you to do. We take things for granted too, don't we? So often we just take things for granted. Today we come in here and we sit down. And you probably took for granted that the pews are here and that the seats are there. I'd have sure surprised you if there was none in here, wouldn't it? But you took it for granted. And I tell you what, some of you take for granted we got air conditioner. There's been a few times we come in here and got surprised. Right? We take things for granted in our lives. You probably never think about who cleans the church up or the kitchen and the other classroom. Who mows the lawn? Who takes out the trash? You know, a while ago we were singing and we all stood up to sing and you sat right back down taking for granted that pew was still there. Didn't you? Remember when you was a kid? Yeah. We take things for granted. You know, God placed our planet in just the right position that it continues to circle the sun at just the right place that we don't freeze to death or burn up. And he does it every day, 24 hours a day. He makes sure our planet rotates correctly. Every second of the day, God keeps it in orbit at just the right place. How often do you think about that? Or how about gravity? Do you take gravity for granted? I say we do. Because when I get in bed, I don't strap down. Right? God's doing all this, man. And if he can take care of those huge things, don't you think he can take care of you if you stepped out your comfort zone for him? I guarantee it he can. Why is it that we can trust God to take care of these huge things in our life and in our universe, but we cannot trust him to do the little things in our lives? We do that, don't we? I'll be honest with you. A lot of times I'll turn something over to God, and about 30 seconds later I'm trying to take it back because I think I'm handling it. Yeah? Y'all know who you are, don't you? Yeah. Guys are really bad about it. God, I need your help here. Now, I'll tell you what I think I'm going to do. Right? Because in our comfort zone, we control things. We control things. In God's kingdom, God controls things. And we all have a free will. So how much do we want to give to God, and how much are we going to try to hang on to? That's that comfort zone we need to break down. We need to have faith. God is operating right in front of our faces every day, everywhere. God is doing things that are vital to our lives, whether we take it for granted, whether we see it or not. Amen? God is at work in us, in our families, in our church, and in our community. Folks, I have no doubt God is talking to people in Afton, Oklahoma, about coming to Him, becoming part of His kingdom. And He needs somebody to go out there and knock on their door and say, hey, would you come to Barn and Cowboy Church? We love you. Or, hey, come down on Wednesdays. We feed for free. He's already set it up. Because He sent Jesus to save the world. And what I mean by that, it's all been paid, and it's all the plan that everybody be in the kingdom of God. But it's not happening. Why is it not happening? There's a few reasons why. We have personal choice. Another is we're not motivated. We're in our comfort zones. We're not being led by the Spirit. We're being led by the world or ourselves. The biggest conflict we have between God is not between God and Satan, but it's between us and God. We try to protect what we want. We try to do what we want. And the Holy Spirit's there the whole time saying, well, I need you to do this. Amen? Let me give you a theological definition of spiritual comfort zone, if you would. A spiritual comfort zone is a state of spiritual behavior within which a believer seeks to live out their Christian life without the presence of any spiritual anxiety and conflict. They adopt a spiritual neutral condition by limiting their spiritual behavior to deliver a non-descriptive level of performance, usually without any sense of spiritual adventure. Let me ask you this. Is everything going all right in your Christian walk? Think about that. Are you a little bit anxiety, got a little anxiety because God's asking you to do something? Huh? Let's break free of these comfort zones, these prisons. God's got some great plans for us. That's a pretty sad description, isn't it? But it's true of many Christians that many churches in the 21st century is living in that deal. We're not doing nothing. We're not changing nobody's lives. We're just taking care of our own. One time when I was a youth minister for a First Baptist church, I was trying to bring in some kids, and we were getting bigger, and we were just getting bigger and bigger, and I had one of the deacons say, hey, stop. We want you to just take care of our kids. What? Yeah. Slow down. I want you to just take care of our church kids. Really? What do you think God thinks about that? Huh? Are we going to be like that? Are we going to be like that? I'll say, unless we get off our backsides and get moving, we're going to fall right into that comfort zone. Oh, I'm Barn Un Cowboy Church. Yeah, I like going down there. They feed us free on Wednesday. Their music's good. They got a pretty cool porch that we're going to start setting out on and doing that stuff. We put up with the preacher. We just going to lock ourselves in here and take care of ourselves? Don't, we cannot settle for spiritual mediocrity. God says, I'd rather you be hot or cold, but don't be in the middle. I guess there's plenty of churches around that's on the cold side. He's all right with that, I guess. I don't want to be mediocre. I want to be on fire. Thus, the sermon, series sermon title is Building a Fire. How do you build a fire? Well, I'm telling you, one of our steps is get out of your comfort zones. Quit being lazy. Start trusting God. Listen, when I say don't quit being lazy, I'm not talking about you actually doing physical work. I'm just saying listen to God and be willing to do what He asks you to do. He may be asking you to get on your knees and pray for somebody. I hope He tells somebody to pray for me. I need it. But He might be maybe all He's asking you to do. And oh, instead of 5 minutes, He might ask you to give 10 or 15. Oh, Lord, have mercy. If I got to talk to God that long. God just told us about that, didn't He? We got to develop that relationship. I talked about the things we need to do before about building this fire. We got to have a good prayer life, don't we? We got to praise Him. We got to worship Him. We got to study the Word of God. Comfort zones. Christians never fulfill what Jesus promised if they stay in their comfort zone. The promise of doing great things as believers. Listen to this one more time. Most assuredly I say to you, he who believes in me, the works that I do, he will do also. And greater works than these he will do because I go to my Father. And whatever you ask in my name, that I will do that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you ask anything in my name, I will do. If you ask anything in my name, I will do. What does that mean? It's not your responsibility. It's your responsibility to listen to the Holy Spirit and ask for it. He will do it. If you love me, keep my commandments. Folks, we're to keep the commandments of God. Now, I've heard this grace thing overused, haven't you? But we need to keep God's commandments. And I will pray to the Father and He will give you another helper. Who is that helper? The Holy Spirit. Do you know who He is? Have you heard from the Holy Spirit lately? Has He spoke to your heart? Has He spoke to your spirit? Have you heard from Him? He says, I'm going to send somebody else. I'm going to send the Comforter. The Spirit of Truth. Do you know who He is? Do you wake up in the morning and go, God, I need a fresh filling of your Holy Spirit because I'm going to make a difference in the world today. Not for me, but to glorify you. Glorify the Father. Jesus saying what is expected of believers that follow Him. Maybe you've read this Bible, you've read this over and over and over, and you have a question maybe. How can I do greater things than Jesus? How do we do greater things than Jesus? The answer was very simple. You need to get out of your comfort zone. Peter stepped out of his comfort zone. John stepped out of his comfort zone. Paul definitely stepped out of his comfort zone. Paul had it going on, you know that? Paul was going to be the great high priest, I guarantee it. He was above it. He was a zealot for his beliefs. He was going to be. He was fast tracking. He was at the top of his game, and everything he believed in was against Jesus Christ. And when Jesus Christ touched him, what did he do? He stepped out of his comfort zone right then. He said, I will not turn my face away from God. Folks, if you're still in your comfort zone, if you're not trusting the Holy Spirit, then basically you're turning your face against God. Ooh, that's hard. That's harsh, ain't it? That's harsh. Does doing things greater than what Jesus did seem a little bit dangerous? Does it seem scary? Or does it sound like something you're willing to do? Which one is it? Exciting. I like that. exhilarating. It's not scary. It's a promise. He'll be there. You know, Jesus cleared the temple. Jesus held religious leaders in his day accountable for their actions. You don't think that was kind of on the edge there? Huh? You know what I'm seeing? The Catholic Church, you know, the Pope is saying some things that the Catholic Church overall ain't liking. Have you noticed that? Have y'all watched any of that, any of you? The Pope's saying some things that the church is going, hey. And there's a few men in the Catholic Church that's stepping out and going, uh-uh. No, Pope. Now, that's a big step, I'm telling you. Because the Pope is the top dude in the Catholic religion. He's the man. He gets it directly from God. And he's saying some stuff that they're saying don't match up with the Word of God. And they're stepping out and they're holding the Pope accountable. That's not been done very often. Why? Because these few men are stepping outside their comfort zone. And they're following the Holy Spirit. And when I say something that doesn't register with your spirit and it doesn't match up with the Word of God, you need to step out of your comfort zone. You need to come tell me. And I promise you will not be executed. I will receive it. And we'll talk about it. Are you willing to step out of your comfort zone so that through Him, through the empowerment of the Holy Spirit, you are able to do great things for the kingdom of God? Are you willing? Or are you just happy with the way it is? Preacher, I wish you'd quit challenging me. I want to come there and sing. I want to say I'm a member at Barn and Cowboy Church. I want to eat free on Wednesdays. Then I just want to go home. Okay? Quit challenging me. Jesus knew the ones that trusted him was going to spread the gospel. Look back. The 12 trusted him, didn't he? Except for the one. He left him. Even old doubting Thomas come around, didn't he? Are you a doubting Thomas? Try him. Just try it. Just stick your hand in the hole. Go ahead. Just one. Just try it. If you've never stepped out of your comfort zone with Christ, do it just one time. See what happens. If it don't go your way, do it again. He'll be there. Will you step out of your comfort zone? Do you believe your Christian life is about stepping out in faith and serving an almighty, all-powerful, all-knowing God whose boundaries are limitless? Do you believe that? Or is your Christian life limited by your comfort zone? When Jesus told his disciples that he was leaving, but he was sending a comforter to replace him, he did not mean that if he was, it was so that they could become comfortable in their service to him. He said, I'm going to send you a comforter, not an Afghan. Okay. I'm going to send you a comfort so that you can step out of your comfort zones and he'll be with you, he'll guide you, he'll direct you to do the mighty work of Christ. Because he already told him, if you ask it in my name, I'll do it. If you'll keep my commandments, I'll do it. If you're working for the kingdom of God, I'll do it. Amen? Do you truly believe God will do it? Get out of your comfort zone. Try him. If anybody hasn't been out of their comfort zone in a while, I got something for you. We got Vacation Bible School week after next. Come give it a try. Not next week, but the week after. I'll be here Monday afternoon, Tuesday, and all day Wednesday, all day Tuesday. We're going to be cleaning this stuff up, making it pretty. So if you ain't never did no garden work, come on. We got to replace all those things around the bushes. I'm just teasing. But God wants you to step out. We're going to try to bring some wagons over here and teams, and we're going to go pick people up for Vacation Bible School. Maybe you can go with us and help us there. Just load, helping people get on. Heck, fire, if you can drive a team, who knows? Might need a break. Oh, you better know how. We're not going to try with it. No, we're not. I appreciate you wanting to step out of your comfort zone. I'm not ready to step that far. All right? God is good. Hey, do you love serving a God that you can laugh with? Man, I'm telling you, I love what we do here. We preach, I hope we preach a good service, a good word service, but we can do it with love and with laughs. And nothing else, you got to laugh the way I talk. I ask you today as we close, and we're going to close right now, will you submit to the leadership of the Father? Will you submit to the leadership of the Father? Because if you say yes, then you need and you're commanded to leave your comfort zone. If you're truly submitting to the leadership of God. If you're truly submitting to the leadership of God, you should crave to have an infilling of the Holy Spirit each and every day. Because he wants you to do great things. And he sent the Comforter. Jesus had to leave here and go back to heaven to send the Comforter to give you power, comfort, wisdom. Amen? So will you submit to the leadership of God? And I'm going to tell you just from experience, I know that God's speaking to some of you here today. Some of you already know the answer. You already know what God wants you to do. And you're sitting there going, well, I wish he'd just come up and tell me. He is. He's already told you. If he's speaking to you, if there's things in your life you need to change, I promise you, he's speaking to you. If he's got a job for you, he's speaking to you. You're the one that's not letting him in. You're the one that's put up the boundaries, not him. You're the one that won't step out. Maybe you need to be filled with the Holy Spirit for the first time. Come on. Step out. And I'll say this, and then I'll let you go home. I promise. I told you I'd close three times every time. If you're not ready for something new in your life through God, then this is not the place for you. Because I'm going to challenge you every Sunday to get up and get out in God. And get excited and get passionate. Folks, the world is changing around us. And believe it or not, they don't want anything to do with Christians or Christianity. They don't want anything to do with our Lord and Savior. They don't want anything to do with our God, Yahweh, the one and only living God. And so in order for us to sustain and to build this kingdom, we've got to get on fire. We've got to step outside our comfort zones, and we've got to feel the filling of the Holy Spirit and listen to him every day. Amen? Amen. Bow your heads, close your eyes. Listen, folks, I love you very much, and God loves you more. Jesus loves you the most. And if Jesus said that he wanted to send the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, back for you, then you better have it. Every head bowed, every eye closed. How many wants more of the Holy Spirit right now in their life? Raise your hand. Thank you, Father. Thank you. Thank you, Father. All right? Thank you, Lord. Lord, Father, you see the hands. You see the desires. Father, I pray for a fresh anointing of the Holy Spirit on each and every one of these ones that raised their hands, and even the ones that didn't raise their hand but still wants more of you, Father. I pray for your Holy Spirit to come raging down right now and filling us, Lord, and encouraging us and giving us power from on high and giving us the comfort we need to step out of our comfort zones and move forward into this world. Lord, we just claim it. You said ask. So we're asking for a fresh anointing of the Holy Spirit. Some of you are here today and you need to step out of your comfort zone and God spoke to you about it. I ask you right now, step out of your comfort zone and tell him you're ready to go. Do it right where you sit. Thank you, Lord. God's telling you, somebody or someone in here, that they need to change the way they're living their life. They're doing the same things over and over and over, and nothing's changing. They're telling you, change the way you live in your life. I don't have to know who you are, but you know who you are. If you need prayer, if you want prayer, when we're done, I'm going to stay up front here. And I want you to come up here and we'll pray. If you want a fresh anointing of the Holy Spirit, I'm going to be here. Come. If you need help coming out of your comfort zone, come. I'll pray. Folks, we need to spread the gospel of Jesus Christ in this dark world that we live in. There's no better time than now. Lord, Father, we love you and we praise you so very much. I thank you for the hands that come up that wants more of you, Father, wants more of your Holy Spirit, that wants that boldness to change the lives of others and themselves, Father. I just thank you so much. Lord, I ask you to be with us. Help us move out of our comfort zone. Lord, and help those individuals that need to make some changes in their life. Give them the knowledge and the discernment and the wisdom to do such. And Lord, I ask for a special anointing on this church gathering here today, Father, that we leave here and take light into this dark world that we live in. And Lord, I just ask for your blessing on Vacation Bible Schools that comes up, Father. I just ask you to touch it and let us just reach out and show love and affection to the young kids in this town, Father, that they may come to know Christ through us. Lord, and just let your Holy Spirit just work on them. And Lord, we just thank you for our blessings. We thank you for what you're doing for us, Lord. We give you all the glory. May your name always be lifted high in each and every one of our minds and our hearts. This we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.